Headrest. Still am. Well, the body won't take quite as much as it used to, but there you go. Sadly, I have to refute the rumours that I don't smoke dope. There have been rumours circulated that I don't. And it's actually bad for my reputation. And the very idea of J.M. with that spliff is a nap. And one life without.
This will sort your foot, man.
Say, inhale gently and let the vapor of the air come to my body. You see? And transfer it to my other toe. And me exhale and all the goodness, see? All humor, them come up the right leg, them run.
People talk about John as a sort of folk singer. It leaves rock and roll. I don't know any rock and roll stories that compare with this, these, you know, acoustic strummers and pickers. But I believe there were absolute nightmares with, you know, personality clashes and substances and stuff like that getting in the way. But every now and then, moments of absolute musical magic, you know, stunning.
See, John, as I learned, is not at all a disciplined musician. You know, if there's an 8-bar sequence or a 12-bar or a 4-bar, he would just make a change whenever he felt like making a change, a bit like John Lee Hooker's a bit like that, let's say. So you really needed a very intuitive, sort of jazz-orientated type musician who could work with him, who could move very quickly when he moved.
Is with John, he swings. So you can be as clever as you like. If you don't swing, forget it. Because if I said to John, play B flat, major 7 flat and 9, I might as well say, play the dimmer plate. We're talking about natural.
I can more or less play anything that I really want to play. I mean, someone who's sight reads will obviously going to get there quicker than you, but it'll be straight. You know, it wouldn't have my edge. I don't like straight chords. Don't like, never did. It's a busy thing. You like broken and shattered and, you know, sort of somewhat tattered, torn at the edges.
We never ever discussed his poetry, his songs, the music content. We just got together and did it. And he never said to me, do this, do that. Never, ever happened. We'd be in the pub, we'd get to the gig, we'd do the gig, and we'd be back in the pub all.
Three, four.
Where's the money?
Well, that was John Martin.
The way is too short. Right. Right, just take the weight off the first repeat. As far as I put it, it allows you a certain degree of freedom. In action.
So it's not any no wine, no women, no song? It's...
Oh no, far from it. Haven't for a friend about it.
See, I had the slightest thing to do with anything like that.
No form of asceticism whatsoever, thank you. But I think I'll drink to that. Here's to asceticism. Of course, quite different asceticism.
I mean, here's your bit of your money.
So does your Buddhism help you cope with your foot?
The acceptance of the inevitable is part of it. I mean, it's a bit like nurturing the attitude of having no fear. And when you kind of run past that, you don't have any, you know what I mean? I mean, when I was wild and young, quite deliberately walk around. Where's the biggest geezer in the place? You know, and hit him. Just for fun. Now, I knew it was the wrong thing to do. But I've stopped all that. And it was the Buddhism what did teach me that it was the wrong thing to do. Daddy, will you sing for me? Daddy, try and sing for me. Daddy, please sing for me. Says, Daddy, don't you cry for me. Daddy, will you fly for me? Daddy, will you try for me? My little whisper, she makes my heart feel tight like a fist. Number one girl in most every way. Our personal relationships away from each other go through stormy things. So we had our own individual, you know, not problems, but getting on with life, you know, and our relationships with our loved ones or wives and girlfriends or whatever. Playing together was a release for a lot of things.
It was a bit of a tricky time because I was working so much and spending so much time away from home that I was losing touch with the kids and stuff. Not the best situation.
He had a life of his own, which I didn't really know about, because he was always on the move, moving constantly, working constantly. You know, gregarious, always, you know, meeting people. I had a child, I had to stay indoors. I stayed indoors, really, and that was it.
John has brought his life into his work, you know, his love songs. They kind of admit to personal failures at times. I've spoken to other people, you know, sensitive souls that don't just go to see him cutting up rough or wobbling about, but like go to see him really work and hear that cry from the soul.
A howling wolf, I mean, wolves only howl for a reason. Men only cry for a reason. Men do cry as well, you know. And that's, you know, I think it's the same thing. It's a sadness, an intrinsic sadness in any creature, which is part of music's real attraction for me. Make no mistake, it's love.
Make no mistake, it's love. Doesn't matter if you're a great artist or play the blues and make everybody cry. It's what you do as a human being that counts at the end of the day. I think when he was sober, he was wanting to get drunk, basically. He was Jekyll and Hyde. He could turn on a sixpence, you know. He would just turn, you know. There was no little nice boy left anymore, you know, smiling and innocent.
At that time, my brother was managing, and he was kind of in the middle of a lot of domestics that were fucking awful, actually. I mean, things I heard. At the same time, however, he recorded Small Hours.
Just him with a complex guitar, and it was recorded at about 3 o'clock in the morning, and it's on a lake. And there's the sort of main railroad line in the difference, which goes from London to Bristol. And on the lake there are all these geese, and you hear that atmosphere at night.